Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Spot Real Talk. My name is Tiara.
I'm Tiffany.
I'm Ron.
And we have our, you know, friend of the show back on with us, Hassan.
Hi, everyone. I'm Hassan.
Welcome back. Glad to have you. We are recapping The Shy today. And before we even get started, we are going to let you know that you need to go and watch our interview that we did with the cast of The Shy, Jason Weaver, Judaea Brown, and Genesis Hale. They killed it. I mean, that interview was so much fun. I think all of y'all will agree. We enjoyed the heck out of that.
Yeah, we did. We had a ball.
Yeah, so you guys need to go and watch that like ASAP. So also make sure you subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell because we got a lot of good stuff up our sleeve. So, you know, we had to get that out the way first.
And the button's in the lower right-hand corner, just in case you're looking for it. Lower right-hand corner.
There you go,
right there. Okay.
If you love the Spot Real Talk, do that for us right now. But like I said, we are here to discuss The Shy today. So if you hang tight, we'll get started in a second. Back to talk about The Shy. This is season 5, episode 6, titled Bring It On Home to Me.
Don't let me break out in the song. I'm fighting.
Yeah, you know, it was a lot. You know, that opening scene where it was a mashup of all the couples kind of getting it on.
I was like,
you know, it's interesting they showed all of these couples that have kind of been on shaky grounds lately. So I'm questioning whether some of them are gonna make it out.
Did y'all see that the beautiful Dom is back? Oh my gosh,
Dom is back. Yes.
Yeah, well, yeah, we hope
so. Only for one episode. I think I saw her tweet that, you know, because she's filming BMF, and I think she's like a regular this season, season 2 of BMF. Right. She's only in The Shy for like one episode this season.
I believe she came back with some timely information for your boy Emmett.
Yes, she did.
Yes, some manly information.
Yes, and I know that's going to be a big part of our discussion, so we might as well go ahead and knock that out first, because Tiffany and Ron have been busting at the seams to talk about this.
And Tiffany is wrong, that's why. She's just wrong.
He does want me to be wrong. He, Ron is not for the girl code. And the thing is, the one thing that this Tiffany, is right about is that, you know, I saw some chatter online and they said that, you know, that Tiff and Keisha are not really friends. They're just friendly. And, you know, and they talked about but both of them acknowledged on this episode that they are friends. Keisha said, Tiff is my friend. Tiff said, she is one of my closest friends. So with that being said, the girl code, if you feel that way about someone, then, you know, that is an issue about dating their ex. So, you know, this is not just any ex. I should qualify the girl code. There are parameters for some girl codes. Like, you might not care about the ex, you know, about, you know, old exes and stuff. Certain people, there's levels to this, you know, but like ex-husbands and baby mama, baby dads, you know, those.
Because there's not a clean break. Like Emmett and Tiff have to be tied together for the sake of that child for a lifetime. And so it's not a clean break.
What about Emmett and Keish can too? They could be husband and wife.
Hold on before y'all go out there. No. Look, she scored a touchdown. My turn. Ball's tipped off to me now. Let me get a chance to score my touchdown. Here I go.
Absolutely.
What did Rob say to Tiffany?
He was right.
He said, why don't you let them be happy? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
And this is where I go with the girl code. I'm not saying that I don't believe you all have it. I know you all have one. I'm not arguing whether you have one or not. But my main point is, if you are happy over there,
mm-hmm.
then you're all of your effort and your energy should be over here. Not over here where you left behind luggage or baggage, whatever it is you left behind. If you're good over here, then you ought to be good over there.
Because I do agree with that, though. I agree with what Rob said when he said we grown.
Like, we grown folk, and people do what people do. And he said, why don't you let them be happy?
It's true. I mean, I understand exactly what you're saying.
But she's not angry. She's not, look, she may be, well, let me put it this way.
She's hurt.
Of course she's angry. She's angry more than hurt. She's angry because it was Keisha.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's not.
I got that. But for it to bother you to the level that it is, something's wrong.
The fact that Keisha and Emmett have a past, that's a part of it. But then it also brings up the question, like, okay, you're saying that you're my friend, but now you're dating my ex-husband, and it makes me question everything that happened beforehand. Like, were you plotting on him while we were together?
But they were together before that.
She brought that up.
But you know what? Y'all know better than that. You know better than that. You know, you
but Emmett was than... dreaming about Keisha while they were together.
Well, yeah, because Keisha. but you know what? Y'all drum up stuff. And what I mean by that is, you know, that she wasn't plotting against you.
We know that as an audience, but when you have a betrayal,
I'm even saying that.
You think about everything. You start playing things back in your head, and sometimes you can get irrational with it.
But it's different. Here's where the difference lies with me. If your ex dropped you for no apparent reason, and then he comes over, and the next thing you know, he's with your girlfriend. Yeah, you can assume that was planned. You can assume that he wanted her more than he wanted you. But you kicked your ex out the door. You said, I don't want you anymore. You're gone. I don't care what you do. He's out the door. And then you get upset as to where he goes.
She's over him though, and I think she
that's what I said. She's not done.
But that's what I'm saying. If you're not done, then let him look. It's no harm and it's no shame in the game. Hey, I still love you, and we need to work something out. Boom.
I'm somewhere in between you and Tiffany on agreeing with both of y'all points.
I still think it's a code. I do think Keisha violated and stuff, but I do get what but Rob said, and what you're saying, Ron, about, hey, we grown, and if you over here, then don't worry about what I'm doing.
Right.
But it is an issue that it was Keisha, though. Like, I think Tiffany would have been like, if it was any other chick, she might have been concerned. But the fact that it's somebody she said is her closest friend, I would question it.
I'm going to tell you why.
If one of my closest friends is going to, and we ain't even, they're not officially divorced yet. I mean, they said... They're not right.
Well, let's not even bring that up because she's screwing Rob to death. So I don't even want
to. Well, I thought that it was too soon for her to move on to Rob. Anyway, I thought that Tiffany should take some time for herself before going to any man.
But let's look at it this way. When he told her it was Keisha, she was more worried about, have y'all screwed yet? I mean, because the first thing that came out of her mouth was, oh, what about your celibacy? Y'all screwing? That was the first thing that came out of her mouth.
So you know it must have meant something if he broke that with her. It must
have. So my point is
see that she's not over him yet little things like that bother her.
This is what gets me about her. If you're not over him yet, then why do you break camp at your mother's house, take your little kid over to some dude's house, and even though the more we see about Rob, the more comfortable I may be getting with him in terms of him being a straight dude. And when I mean straight, I mean cool. You know, I can get that. But what I don't get from you, Tiff, is what's all this back and forth with with what you want versus what you don't want?
I think it is that she is in a space where she's so hurt by what Emmett did to her that she is really not taking the time for herself, like Tiffany said, to work through her emotions. Instead of jumping into a new relationship, she really should have taken some time to sort her feelings.
Yeah.
When she's over here with Rob, she's still trying to build something. Like, they have not really established a really strong bond yet. Right. And so she's really having that grass is greener syndrome. She thought things were going to be better with Rob. And now, like you said, Ron, you know, she's seen how Emmett has transformed, and seeing him move on with somebody so close to her really is hitting home now that she might have made a mistake. And I think you're right, Ron, that she is really going to be regretful very soon.
I think so too. I think at the end of the day, she and Rob may not be an item.
And it's a bigger point than that, right? And I don't know if y'all really realize it too, right? When her and Rob was in the car, how she expressed, Emma, you better not be trying to get back Bradley one more. That's what she really wanted him to do. That's why she got there, right? And I'm gonna go even a little bit deeper, right? It hurts her so much because of the fact that she knows the history with Keisha, right? And that was somebody he confided in always. They've always truly been friends, right? That's something in them two never had, but him and Keisha always had. And he said it too. We've been there for each other. We've been through a lot. And she was like, Keisha was like, yeah, we have. And they haven't. They don't have that bond.
For Tiff, it probably makes her feel inadequate that exactly. I was a wife and I still couldn't provide this same thing
that I have with Keisha. Exactly. She's never given herself a chance to be adequate. I mean, here's the thing. My point is, and you know, you keep talking about being hurt, but I don't understand a woman that marries somebody who has, if she was hurt, then why did she get married?
Because sometimes I think for Tiff, she really was hoping that the marriage would solve all their problems.
We all know that. Getting married.
A lot of women, well,
realistic with how
we should know. We should know by now.
No, no, not Eric. You shouldn't say Eric. You should know because a lot of people are idealistic about it. Yes.
Okay, so let's
until they are actually in there.
No. Look, I'm good. I'm ready. I'm packed with. Look, my gun is loaded. I got all kind of bullets. I'm ready for you. So let me say this. let me put it to you this way. It wasn't Emmett that said, let's have an open relationship.
Right.
It was you. So if you were hurt in all this, and then you were idealistic, but then you get into the marriage, and you're the first one that wants to go out and play. You're the first one that is indecisive about whether the marriage should even exist or not. You're the first to go out and say, this marriage is over. So I'm not understanding the hurt part. And I'm not understanding the idealistic. I'm not understanding the idealistic aspect of it either. Look,
the pain is really the problem. Yeah. All of her decisions have been so off par from somebody who really isn't hurt, from somebody who is being rational. Like the pain is what's causing her to be kind of irrational.
If a man did the same thing.
That she has done, the exact same thing. If you reverse the role,
I would say
would have no sympathy on him.
That's not true.
No, you wouldn't see the soft side.
Look, we're not even gonna have a battle of the sexes up
in here. Yeah, I was gonna say that's not true.
That's gonna take it somewhere else.
But we always discount it. You know, it's like I'll tell you how it's like. It's also like the attitude that women take when they'll say, well, you know, it's okay for a man while in a relationship to go out and have sex. But when a woman does it, we all have a lot of chatter about it. Y'all got chatter about it when men do it. You call us dogs. I mean, wait a minute.
But it is different, though. It's not different
because you call us dogs.
You are overgeneralizing right now.
Okay, yeah, he is. He is overgeneralizing.
I'm not overgeneralizing.
You need to stick to the matter at hand, which is tough.
This is the matter at hand. I hear a lot of sympathy going to Tiffany, but what I'm simply saying is
it's not sympathy. It's stating the obvious. First of all, Tiff and Emmett are early 20s. How many 20-year-olds have it figured out about themselves and relationships and marriage? I told you, I got married young and I was definitely idealistic about marriage. And then when you're in it and have to deal with everyday life and stuff, you grow up quick. And I think that's what it was. She was hopeful.
Did you leave your marriage?
And Ron, I think the part that you're missing is that we're not saying Tiff's behavior is okay.
We're not excusing her behavior.
Why aren't we talking about her behavior? Because here's where I'm going.
Because
why
not we had so many past recaps. But
what I'm saying is, why not talk about her behavior and how it has affected Emmett in this relationship now headed toward Keisha? I understand how I understand how Tiffany can be hurt. So don't get it twisted. I understand how she can be hurt. But what I'm simply saying is it's behaviorism that's got Emmett where he is. Because what I'm saying is, well, you know, like the whole idea about she being forced out of her own mother's house.
When we're not disagreeing with you, Ron. I think that's the part you're missing. We're not disagreeing.
No, I'm not. Believe me, I don't miss the part. I'm just simply saying is we're not paying attention to how A and B became C. We're looking at ways of why she is the way she is, but we're really not answering the question. Then if she's all hurt and she has feelings for Emmett still, then why isn't she trying to save and solve her marriage?
Because we're on episode 6, I think it's coming. I think now that she sees that Keisha's in the picture, I think she's gonna have a change of heart. Watch.
Yeah, I agree.
Is that a change of heart or a change of mind?
Both.
No,
because I think in her heart,
she still has feelings for Emmett, but in her mind, she's trying to deny that she has feelings.
Or she's so just right trying now, to keep, she's or she's just trying to keep Keisha her. From having Emmett. And that's what I mean by change of mind. If it's a change of heart and she is truly wants to make it with Emmett and get back to that relationship, I'm all for that. Don't get me wrong. And I would suspect or hope that if that's what she truly wants, that Emmett would see it and say, okay, you're still my wife. We have a kid. I need to come over here. I need to fix this. We need to get this relationship.
I think Emmett would be over it if she
I think she would too, because I didn't like the way she talked to him in at the car. She was just like, and you better not be trying to beg for me and all this stuff. I was just like, really?
She showed him who she is a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
It's a masculine too.
Exactly.
I was just like, I didn't like the way she talked to him. In front of your new boo too. So I just was like,
Now you're making my point. You are now exactly making my point.
We were never in disagreement though.
We weren't in disagreement on that.
No, you're not in disagreement, but what I'm simply saying is it's a cause and effect type thing. And I only want to deal with the cause and the effect. Cause and the effect. This is why Emmett is where he is. I'm not protecting Emmett from his past. I'm not doing that. You had no reason. Well, he had reason because he wanted to do it. But that's not something that you should have done. You did it, and you should have paid for it. And but. Emmett has changed and he was evolving. And he now has evolved. So my thing is, lady, Miss Tiffany, if you really want your marriage, say so.
Yeah.
I think that's gonna happen. I think she's gonna end up speaking up.
And I don't want to spend too much time on this because we already spent a lot of time on it.
Sorry, I had to get it out of my chair.
I just want to ask you guys how you felt about the decision for Emmett to solely go alone and talk to Tiff.
They should have done it together. When I saw it, I was like,
They would have been in fighting.
I don't trust Tiffany that would have. I can't see Tiffany would have looked at Keisha.
He did it the right way by being a man, stepping up. He made that decision. By going to his child mother, like, listen, he was scared, but he, like, you know, he told her, this is why I wanted to do it out in public. I didn't want to do it at the house because Keisha was still back at the house, and he didn't want to bring that drama to the house in case she did jump on him if they're out in public. You know what I mean? And it's a hurtful decision on both parts, you know, because Keisha's about to lose a friend, and Emmett, he's like, wow, he really didn't want to hurt her, but his heart is with Keisha.
And you can tell this is really tearing Keisha up. Just not answering her texts or nothing.
Yeah.
So she's really kind of like, it seems like she almost want to backtrack and be like, nah, Emmett, I can't do this. But, you know.
They got to move forward now.
What's done is done.
Right. Well, you know, you backtrack. Yeah, I, look. Okay. I don't even know where to begin with this. Tiffany, to me, is going down a very, very slippery slope. And I say that to say, even now she wants to get, now she not only wants to be involved with Rob, but she actually wants to get involved with the drug game.
Right.
So I'm not exactly sure where Tiffany is now. Yes, we can say that she was emotionally hung up and that, you know, and things of that sort about Emmett and the relationship with Emmett. But it's gone deeper than that. It's a lot darker than that now. And the fact that you want to get in the game just to make money, and you got a little kid.
And she's already in the game. Money. She's
trying No. I'm talking about she now wants to meet the...
She wants to meet the supplier. Which,
she wants to go independent.
She wants solo. She wants to go solo.
Right. Very foolish about how dangerous it truly is.
That's extremely dangerous. Extremely dangerous. And the fact that you got a little kid, too. So she's really traveling down this dark path that I saw coming with her attitude change with Emmett.
And I'm a little upset with Rob for letting her do it.
Well, yeah. So
I wanted to give her... He wanted to give her an independency. That's all it was.
Well, no, I'm not prepared for that, though. But Rob has been a little too soft with her. It's not... He seems... To me, he needs to rein her in a little bit. I mean, you know, even when he started to talk about the relationship with Emmett and Keisha, by saying, well, let them be happy, but it's his tonality. He's so gentle.
He's laid back. But he said what he said, and it was mic drop. And he walked away after that.
But that could be because he's high all the time, too. So
But you know, but when he walked away, that kind of let me know that he's getting a little tired of
That's why I said she on shaky ground.
Yeah, because she's going to wind up having nobody.
Right.
That's what I'm thinking.
And the part where, you know, the dude tells him he's the middleman and that she really can't meet Q. I was like, Q, you mean Quentin? Is that the plug?
Uh-oh.
Because I was like, if Q is Quentin, then that's a big problem. He is super dangerous, as we have seen.
Yes, he is.
And so I was like, Tiff, you know, she admitted that she made a stupid mistake, but I'm like, sis, you too far gone now. You done already met these people. They just shook you down thinking you were in a wire and some more. So I'm like, why did it take that for you to realize what you're getting yourself into?
I was wondering why. I know that she and Dom are, you know, in business with him and stuff, but I was just like, she said she wanted to meet the supplier, and I'm like, why are you making those demands? I mean,
he's talking about independence and not having to rely on Rob for her well-being, but I'm like,
I hear that, but I was like,
not the way, sis.
You need to go get a job. And you know something, it's even something that Dom said to Emmett when Emmett said he got problems. She said, you always got problems, and he's, you know, and she said, what it's about Tiff or something to that effect. And she said, look, if Tiff was okay with you and I hooking up, if she dealt with that, I'm sure there's nothing you can tell me that she can't handle. Wow. I mean,
she actually did one better. She broke the whole scenario down. She was like, you sleeping with me sleeping with your dad, going but back to your mom.
I'm just getting back to how Tiffany is so hurt because, you know, my thing is a whole lot of y'all would have ended that relationship once he made, okay, it's one thing to have his past, but then when he hooked up with Dom at the store and then went and told Tiff, for most of you all, that would have been it. That would have been the straw that broke the camel's back, but it wasn't. So she's on a different timetable. I don't know what it is, but it ain't all about Emmett. It's something in her spirit that's moving her forward. And we're beginning to see it with her wanting to get into the game of selling, of, you know, being a dealer.
And the middleman was Nuck, who we
Yeah.
And he was, she claimed he was responsible for Keisha's kidnapping. So I'm like, well, now you are dealing with two very dangerous people.
Right.
So I'm like, you know, her whole train of thought has been super off. Like this entire season, so I really hope Tiff can get it together.
I think it's more so of gaining financial freedom, because you know her being in a situation with Emmett, them robbing Peter to pay Paul, and her having for a period of time being that provider, him getting a restaurant, and still her doing her own thing, and her not being able to be taken care of, then get her getting with someone that's very much financially stable. But she really don't want to be with him, right?
Think about it, though, because she could have had she stayed with Emmett. Emmett already has a successful restaurant chain. And, you know, I think Tiff and Dom had previously talked about incorporating, the marijuana into the food right, and stuff food, like that. Right, so right. They could have opened up a spinoff chain of Smokies and had a
it really be Smokies.
and let me say this.
And I'm like, she had ways and avenue to independence had she stuck in there and like really see things through.
And being a drug dealer does not provide you with financial freedom. I mean, to tell you, you've got to get your money washed. There are so many things you got to do to be successful at that game, and few are successful. So, you know, it's a fallacy to believe that you can receive financial freedom in the drug deal. You're not free because you always got somebody on your back. It's either the police, it's either the people that work for you, or another rival gang that wants your position. So you're hardly free from anything. In fact, it brings more on you than
target.
Oh my God, you're targeted at each and every front.
And her being a woman too.
And being a woman.
Right. Yeah. I mean, but the marijuana business, not saying that I've been indulging either, but the marijuana business is a lot different because it's legal down there now. And she see the freedom that he has now from having his own marijuana establishment.
The guy said you could have got yanked coming through the door. Ain't no different, bro. Ain't no different. Yeah. She could have got yanked the moment she went through the door.
Yeah.
But you really think she could have known who her man was? They wouldn't.
That's my whole point. You don't know anything,
right?
And to assume or think that you do, this is a drug game that you don't know anything about,
right?
And you don't just walk through that door like that.
Yeah,
you could have got, I mean, you could have got popped just for being.
Yeah, so I hope Tiff gets it together though. We gonna see because it ain't over yet. But I want to talk about another couple who is, you know, may or may not be on the rock soon, Darnell and Jada. You know, the way Darnell talks to Jada, and you know, he's kind of like just going back to the same old type thing.
Backslide.
Like, it's not gonna really last. And I think Jada is really thinking with the rose colored glasses too. I think she had all this spoiling. She's been spoiled by Suede, and now she's taking that same standard from Darnell when that's not who he really is.
No.
And so, you know, she sets up this date night. They go out stepping, you know.
Yes. Steppers. You're reminding me of Love Jones, Darius and Nina.
And it was a very nice date. But we see, you know, they get home and Jada's, you know, ready to put on the lingerie and Darnell's over here passed out.
He knocked out.
So I'm like, you know, I think she had the rose colored glasses too, thinking that the grass was going to be green on the other side. When really she's too hopeful about her situation with Darnell, because at his core, he hasn't really changed who he is. He's tweaking his behavior to her liking.
Right.
But that's not really who he is.
But I think she wants to take Darnell a little slower than Darnell appeared to want to be.
Because he's talking about marriage.
No, that's what I'm saying.
She wants marriage.
No, but remember what she said in the bed when Darnell said, we need to take this a little further. And she was like, well, what do you mean? I mean, I just got out of this thing with the...
She did say that. Yeah. But when he talked about coming under one roof and sharing bills, she was like, I'm not doing that unless that's a husband. Yes. And then when he ain't respond, she was like, oh, what? Okay. Like, so that's not your end game.
No, but then she knows Darnell. See, and this is what I like about Jada. I mean, she knows Darnell, and she can smell it when he changes up, you know. And I did like what Darnell said, you know, why don't you take me out sometimes? That was a good move.
That was.
And, you know, and she took him to a place that he could enjoy. And so I like what I see with the two of them. And I'm really prayerful in the character sense, that they make it, you know, and decide to get back together, because there is a couple that's been divorced for some time and they're working their way back. They're beginning to know one another again and they're working their way back. Maybe it's because of their age, I don't know, but at least I see some plausibility that they could make it back.
And women, that was a cute date.
Because women, y'all more thoughtful. I'm gonna give y'all credit. Because you see what he said, just let me know which Red Lobster you want me to show up at. You know, and she was very thoughtful in regards to something that makes him happy, right? Women, y'all pay attention to details. Y'all, y'all very great with that. Like, man, he was cool with Red Lobster. You know, she wanted to do something different so she can get a different result, right?
That's class, brother.
That is.
Women got a little more class.
Oh, man. I give him credit. Kudos to y'all. But and I think it's going to require him and cause him to step up, right? I think he's going to do the right thing because now he realizes being with someone younger, of course, Dom, you know, who was, you know, his son been with her, he had her. But then really the one he always wanted to be with was her. So if she's holding him and expecting him to do everything that she needs, he's going to step up. I believe he's going to step up and do the right thing by her.
The first date he took her on was cool. I mean, that was a nice thing. Right. So he knows what to do. The question is, will he do it?
But he got to be held accountable sometimes. Man, you know, we got to be held accountable sometimes.
Well, see, the fact that you had her and lost her because you weren't accountable, and now you say you want to be accountable, but every few seconds you slip back to the old Darnell, what has she got to hang on? You know,
that's the thing, though, because if that's not who you are, if it doesn't come natural to you to do those things, right, it's not going to last. And it's only so much those date nights can do to keep y'all together.
Absolutely.
And that's why I'm like, I see cracks in the foundation because Darnell is still who he is.
Absolutely.
And Jada coming from also being with a younger person, her expectations are way higher now because Wade had her tailored to a certain way of living, doing all of
this. Wade was a good dude.
He had her out doing all of this fun, excited things. Like, he bought her a new breath of life, bringing her to her youthful side again.
But you know what,
Darnell is bringing her back to her age. And I don't think she wants to live in her, like, she wants to be who she is, but still be youthful.
But the reality of that situation, too, was, what if, I'm sure it hit her, what if he wants to have children, right? She's not having no children at the age of
school. Oh, no, I don't think he's one of them.
Long term, but I'm saying the way he made her feel.
Of course.
Right.
Yeah, I don't see either one of them really wanting children. They're too old.
She was talking about when she was with Sway.
Oh, yeah. She was with Sway. That's what I'm talking about.
She was taking
that. You know, older women think of the reality of it all. After all the smoke clear and then, you know, he get a chance to exercise on her a little bit and she like that. Right.
Yes.
So the reality kicks in and then she like, all right, now I know little Keisha with the big booty gonna walk past him and she probably fertile and he's gonna jump on that, right?
Because we know she probably don't want Suede for real.
That's what I think.
It's really, she's just longing for the feeling of
it. Yeah, I think she was with Suede only for the physical aspect.
Push-ups. She wanted to do push-ups.
Well, I think she cared about it, too, because he also held her down during that cancer.
She's not evil. And what he provided her was exactly what she wanted. She wanted to be treated like a queen or special.
Yeah.
And he gave her. But I think that in her heart of hearts, she knew that he was just a little too young for her. She wants someone she could relate to. You know, and that's always a case with relationships or May-December relationships. The question is, can the younger person relate to the older person? Because you can't expect the older person to come down to your level because they've already gone past that. You have to step up to their level and understand their needs, understand how they behave because they've earned that. They're older. And I think Sway did a good job about that, which is why I don't think he would have wanted children from her because he knew she was too old to have them. I personally think that was the best thing for her. However, I get it. I understand what she wants. She wants to relate to somebody. Like, you know, Bring It On Home to Me, that song. You know, that's a Sam Cooke song. You want somebody that understands that song, not somebody to go, what's that?
Right,
you know,
exactly.
So,
right.
You know, you want that. You know what I mean?
Right, and he went to school with her son. She was out of pocket for even letting that go down anyway. I ain't let nobody come in the house that I went to school with my mom. Like, you know what I mean?
Listen, she grown.
Knock it off, cuz.
I know. No, let it go. You always going to go there.
This ain't how Stella got her groove back now.
Jada got her groove back.
Right, absolutely.
It's all right, though. But we got some more ground to cover. On to another relationship that's on the rocks. Vic and Tierra definitely are on the rocks. She seems like she is really micromanaging him.
Yeah.
And she's trying to, like, give him all these points and tips and speaking for him. And, you know, just really jumping out ahead of anything. Like, before he can even speak, she answering. So it's like, I think Trig is getting very irritated by her.
Yeah.
And the fact that he has this thing going on with Fatima in the background is kind of like even more motivation.
Yes.
And that's why yes. he's more getting more and more frustrated, because he's had a taste of that sauce that he likes. And mm-hmm. you know, and right now he is realizing that he is living a lie. And how that
the pastor called him out too.
And the pastor did.
Pastor.
But pastor needed like how does that need to be quiet?
No
credibility.
But let me say this. Let me finish this my thought, because I'm getting too old to hang on him with these thoughts now. But I think that, you know, Victor is beginning to understand that the relationship or the supposed relationship he has isn't real. He figures that he can get something real going with Fatima. And that's where he really wants to be. And he's really beginning to say, to hell with this campaign. I'd rather just be me and have what I want, mm-hmm. as opposed to all this glitz and glamour that he's getting. Because, you know, well, I think he's a little deep in now to kind of pull out and say, well, this is fake and this is what I want. You know,
I think he can spin it.
His handlers is not going for that.
But what he can do is say, you know, the campaign has put a lot of strain on my relationship with Tierra, and sometimes mixing work and my personal life is really not ideal for my situation. So Tierra and I have agreed to sever our relationship, but we will still work together professionally.
I like that pivot.
But then y'all got to remember where they at though, right? We're talking about Chicago. She's trying to be the Michelle to his Barack, right?
But if they continue to work together, they can still get what they want.
Yeah, but you know, it's always about how things look. It's always about
optics.
Everything is about optics. I mean, people can care less about what you really are. You know, we had a president, a former president, that proved that. So, you know, I'm not naming anybody, but I think y'all know what I'm talking about. But my whole point, everything is about optics. You know, you know, you can sell anything. You know, the question is it worth buying?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it's up to Trig to make that decision. And Fatima is worried about looking like the mistress, and so it's only so long she's gonna stay in the background anyway. So Trig is at a real crossroads. Mm-hmm. And I thought that what Tierra did this week with that speech and trying to force him to put his mom's business out there when she still isn't even fully recovered,
right.
was a bit much. I was like, you might be pushing it, because it's almost like you exploiting your family.
Mm-hmm.
Still in a very fragile state.
Mm-hmm. I think
his decision to talk about Shad instead was a much better.
That was dope. That was
it. Was, but even Shad looked like he was kind of uncomfortable and everything.
That was his business out there.
I'm sorry. I wanted to catch this before we went on about what you just said about Victor being at a crossroads. Remember when Roz unveiled the new rock? And
it was dead wrong.
He didn't know anything about it.
Tracy
didn't know anything about it.
Blindsided.
I'm gonna tell you that when you get blindsided like that,
mm-hmm.
already being on the fence of whether you really want to go through this or not, mm-hmm. I think that's enough to push him over.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you know, Roz telling him, like, you work for me.
Exactly.
It's like, you really kind of, Trig was in a position where he really could have had a lot of power. But once you hear those words and you really understand, they're like, okay, no matter what I do in this community, no matter how much good I do, I'm still under somebody's thumb. And I think that's why he had that conversation with Tracy, where he was like, you know, are we even making a difference? You know, it's like, what are we doing this for if ultimately we still working with criminals?
Right. And he signed an NDA and paperwork and stuff. So he's kind of locked in.
And he can't talk about it at all.
I think
losing his mom, I think that might send him in that place of, you know what, I got to do what's best for me.
But there's a way he can get out of that NDA. There's a way he can get out of that NDA. Because, you know, when he understands the criminality that's going on, and how that is directly associated with something that he has to come to terms with. We've already lost.
Do I smell the expose coming?
There you go.
That's not gonna they're going to take. They still got to do that to ain't you.
Do I smell the expose? And then he got the team on his side to put it out there?
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Still in the cut.
Put a dot. That sentence is finished. Period. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was going to mention that I think that what Shaw did changing his speech kind of hurt Peaches really bad.
It did hurt her.
And she was kind of left a note behind saying she'd rather them remember her as being sober than for her to disappoint them again, which is kind of like, I understand where Trig is coming from because they have been let down so many times before. And I think Peaches she does understand that. But I think it's also discouraging for her to feel like y'all don't believe in me enough.
That part, I can see both sides, you know, because she was, her feelings were hurt because she did feel like he didn't believe in her. And at the end of the day, you know,
she wound up doing the very thing that she was, that they were afraid of that she would do in the first place. Now she split. So
she split because her feelings were hurt. She didn't want to be a burden and stuff. And I think with him, you know, then, you know, he's a grown man and everything, but no matter how old you are, you still want the relationship with your parents. Mm-hmm. And you can see that, you know, especially when he read that note, he broke down.
Yeah.
He was hurt.
Wounds take a long time to heal. And if you're the perpetrator of those wounds, you have to respect and understand that it takes people a while. So you getting in your feelings, you need to learn to swallow that, because they've been in their feelings for decades.
Yeah.
And now you just show back up. You can't expect everything to be rosy just because you came back into the picture. I understand how she felt, but you wound up doing the very thing that they said that you would, that they were afraid that you might do. Mm-hmm. And if that didn't run across your mind and stop you, I don't know what would have.
Yeah. I think he's gonna end up going after her. They probably won't look for her.
Yeah, maybe. But you know,
yeah,
it's tough because, like I said, he was in a tough spot to try to show, you know, some people, give an example of people in the community that have changed their lives. And so again, going back to that Shad thing, he put Shad on the spot, although he might have been well intentioned. I don't know how Shad is gonna receive that when they have a personal conversation. And then too, with in a conversation with Tracy, I think she was also very discouraged by what Roz did with Rock, because she came out and told him, like, look, I'm not who you think I am. I got the dark side too. And she admitted to him all that stuff. So Trig has had so much on his shoulder, I think, with the campaign, with what's going on with Rock, with what's going on with his mom. And then even as Jake tried to come to him and tell him, Jake was asking about his mom, like, where she go? And, you know, Trig kind of spazzed out on him a little bit. And it don't look like it's getting no better next week.
Yes.
It's
going to be friction.
Right. And I think it might be the reverse of that with Rashad, right? Just think back to when he met the woman that he's with now, you know, how he said he never had a woman care for him and say the things that I think it's also being a life full of incarceration. He had nobody a compliment on him or anything, give him praise for doing something positive and making that transition. He thought that transition that he's making is natural, right? Mm-hmm. But he didn't get an award. He didn't get no kudos. He didn't get any type of praise until then, because the look on his face looked like, wow, oh, these people, yeah, they're clapping for me. Wow. You know, so I think it was that.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, going back to our interview with Jason Weaver and
right,
Hale and Judaea Brown, but Jason Weaver brought up, like, how Shaw's character has really transformed.
Yeah.
And going from that very negative person and kind of having that bad aura in the first season, how he has transformed this season into somebody who is really positive in the community and trying to make a difference. Like you said, I think that goes a long way for his character to feel that love that he's been missing for so long.
Right.
So who were those ladies that he was looking at on his phone?
I love you, Jason,
but you know.
He said, I love you to Deja last week. And then he's on the phone looking at Nubian Queens.
He was backsliding.
Well, I'm not going to say backslid, but I'm just trying to understand.
But he got He got Nubian queens sending him.
But that's the power of social media. Y'all know what it's like. The women on
morning, there. Like, sending him morning salutations. No, right. What happened to the I loved you last week? I thought
still loving. He looking but don't touch him. He don't look him but don't touch
him. No,
I don't know that. I'm
I think he is very happy to feel appreciated, especially by the ladies. You know?
Right.
Yeah. That's gonna be a problem if he do too much appreciating. That's they just gonna be. She gave him a chance now, and you out here.
All she has to do is see what's on his phone, and that's the end of that relationship.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so Chad better tread lightly.
Yes, he gonna get it together. He gonna get it together.
Oh, man, look. Look, delete. Look, delete.
Yeah, right.
He better. We seen how they got Jada caught up. We don't
want that's right.
But going back to the situation with Jake and Peaches, because we mentioned how Jake was looking for her. I think once he realizes she's gone, he's going to be heartbroken, and that might create some more friction with him and Trig, too.
That's what I was thinking.
That message to Jake before she left, she's like, you know, I think you're going to be a really good father. You're going to be a better father to your child than I was as a mother to you. And I think, you know, and he said, you know, it's okay, Mom, you did the best you can do. And the fact that they had just reconciled and kind of come to a better place.
That's going to hurt him.
She rolls out. Oh, Jake is gonna be torn.
Yeah, he's gonna be mad. He's gonna say the trick like, "What did you say to
her? What did you do?" Right.
Yeah. So
he finally got his mom back.
And you think that would have been enough to keep her there? I mean, he forgave her.
Yeah.
He clearly forgave her and said, "You did the best you could do." And you would think that that would have been enough for her to say, "Okay, I'm gonna be strong enough to stay here, even if it's just for Jake."
Which Trig made her feel like she didn't belong though, like when she wouldn't talk about it and stuff and everything. She felt like she was a burden, and that's why
that was selfish of her too, because he was correct in regards to you don't want to give praise to her during this time yet if you don't trust her, right? Because he's in a very special place in his life. Now, what if he gets to this point and then they're going to glorify his mom backslide and fall back into that trap of addiction?
Yeah.
So he's waiting patiently, as he should, just to see how long she stays on his correct path.
Yeah, I could too.
But it was selfish for her to walk away during this time, this the most important time of his life. He's making a transition in his life. He needs his mom, and they're stronger with her there than not there.
And she seemed to have realized earlier on that it would take a while because, you know, she understood why they felt the way they felt. And you know, so I guess she thought it was all supposed to just wash away because he, you know, didn't read the script about her, and instead he mentioned Rashad. I don't know. I don't know how to feel about it, but I think walking away is not the ideal place for her.
Right. And then, you know, now that we know for sure that Jemma is keeping the baby, she and Jake sat down, had the conversation. And you know, it seems like they're excited, but they're scared at the same time.
Absolutely.
And so it's still shaky as to where this goes.
She about to manage this hot rapper. You know,
I think she's gonna change her mind at the last minute, y'all. I think she's saying that now, and I think she's gonna have a change of heart, and I think she's gonna be like, I can't do it. I'm not ready.
Mm-hmm. And you know, Judaea, as she was in the interview, she talked about, you know, her putting herself in that position, you know, in preparation for the role or whatever. She talked about, you know, putting herself in the slot of a teenager who is pregnant, and how that fear and the fear of the unknown really is what's scary for her, and how she was able to put that on screen. So again, check out that interview. And we talked about Super Hot Rapper, as Hassan just mentioned.
Yes.
Genesis, what an amazing person. Like, I did not know that she really does this in real life.
Right.
And she talked about it in our interview too, because she fits. And she gave us an impromptu freestyle.
Yes.
It wasn't impromptu. I asked for it. Like, that's just
It was still a freestyle.
It was freestyle, but not impromptu. I asked for it, and she put it down.
Right on point.
Exactly.
She's talented.
Genesis does it, and Maisha is blowing up too. You know, Jemma was kind of giving her the tips to kind of put a catchy hook onto her song, and it paid off because it sounded really good. As Maisha's career starts to develop and they're talking about doing open mics, if Jemma is going to be her manager, you know, and we see this next episode, Jemma is kind of being questioned by Maisha, saying, how are you going to manage me as an artist?
And was a baby.
And it's like, she got some tough decisions to make. Right. And she might, like a lot of the people in the show, might be looking at things through those rose-colored lenses, but not really realizing the reality of what it's going to be. And how hard it might be for her to balance being a teenage, still in school, balancing a career, and a baby, and her relationship with Jake. I mean, it's a lot. Even for an adult, so imagine a child.
Right.
Because we see Keisha look like she's struggling next week.
Exactly.
So it's nothing that's going to be for the faint of heart. I think Jemma going to really have to think about and prepare herself for how hard it's really going to be. And even with the support of her family, you know, just because her father is well off and has resources doesn't automatically mean that that's going to be extended to her. Like, she gonna have to really think hard about that. So I'm hoping for the best for them. And Tiffy, I know you're doubtful that she's still gonna keep it. But it seems like right now they're hunkering down and saying they gonna do it.
Well, you know, she's got Jake on her side too, and Jemma's dad. So I mean, all points, you know, everything points to she perhaps keeping that baby. So
I mean, that's what they say, but I mean at the end of the day, I mean, she's young and sorry, I think it's her body. As you said, I think she's, you know, I don't know.
And you know, it was funny to me too, because going back to the Keisha and Emmett thing, Keisha seemed to put on the reality lenses and say, like, hold up, between me and Emmett, we got four kids. And so it's like, we can be in the honeymoon phase all we want, but once reality kicks in, we got to really take this serious and realize what it truly is.
My boy Emmett stepped right up and said, I got you. I got up.
The difference is with Jake, though, he's still young too, and he's not established. Right. So it's like, Jake is not really in a position to reassure Jemma in that way. So it's still very uncertain for them.
Now, he's really got on some rose-colored glasses because, you know, in high school, you're talking about taking care of a baby at minimum wage and, you know, and not being able to work a full-time job because you're in school.
And he has a guardian.
Yeah.
But look who his brother's about to be, though, because they're going to have the resources.
But so like I said,
from that perspective,
it doesn't automatically mean those same resources is going to trickle down. And we can see they already got friction in that house.
And not to mention, the you know, his brother is not in charge of himself. That's a mess waiting to happen.
And the for next week, it seems like Trig is more concerned about how it's going to look to his base than
I was going to say that
being concerned with Jake and his feelings.
It's a scandal.
Yeah, so it's like, I mean, Jake is really not feeling the fact that he's not being attentive to how he feels.
Right.
So that's something else. We're going to have to wait and see for next week. I guess the last topic of conversation for this episode was Simone and Kevin, because, you know, Kev got invited to this new gaming group and he's really excited about it. And just like he went and supported Simone on her costume party, she's supporting him now, kind of.
She went because she said
well,
she can be there to support him, even though
give him good energy.
But when he went there, we didn't see her. He walked through the door by herself.
Well, we didn't see him.
But she said she was gonna,
Give him energy, good energy, or something to that effect. Okay. But the interesting part about his old girlfriend sitting on the couch.
Didn't I tell y'all that when I asked y'all the question in another recap, I was like, does Lene look at him like a brother or does she really like him? There was some friction. She was like, I don't see you anymore. And then the exchange between her and Simone, even though Simone was being a little, you know, I think she was being a little pushy in this episode. There was some things that, you know, I thought she was being a little pushy.
Marking her territory.
Yeah, and I but yeah, I think there's something there with Lene and Kevin. And in previews for next week, you see Lene with him at the gaming thing.
Yeah. And I think what it is I don't think it's that she's really interested in him like that. I think she misses the camaraderie.
Right. Yeah.
A lot of time together in a non kind of relationship way. Like, she doesn't have family. Her brother's in
lost the bad news. Got the bad news about her.
So in that household, all she really has
is Kevin. Is
the adult. And Kev was like her partner in crime. Like, they really bonded together over the game and stuff. So when Kev goes off and he's all into his relationship, she doesn't have anybody else to turn to. And I think that's the base of the issue.
Well, even so,
the fact that Simone doesn't really relate to the gaming world and she's not all that interested, it's only fitting, I think, that he would take Lene going forward. But Simone might really be the problem. Like you said, she's pushy. So she
I noticed that.
But she did say, Simone did say, once Lene stormed upstairs, she said, "You gotta do better on your time.
Working your time."
So she's basically saying, "You gotta put in some time with her and not just me." So I gotta give her kudos for that.
That's a good point too, Ron, because at least she's showing some maturity in that situation and not being territorial, like, "Oh no, why is she tripping about you hanging with her?" Or something. Like, so she handled that well.
Exactly. I think.
So you're right about that. Mm-hmm. I think it could work out for Kev where he can find a balance where they can all find something they like in common and do that together.
Mm-hmm.
But Lene's going to have to understand that Kev is still a young boy. He's a teenager and he is interested in a relationship type way with Simone. Mm-hmm. And so that's always probably going to take, you know, the highest priority over spending time with Lene sometimes.
You think so, though?
I think so.
Bond with gaming, and now you see the next one. He's back at the gaming place. You know, I think that might bring them closer.
It's a $25,000 reward at stake.
Right. So that gaming might take.
Oh, and not to mention, Simone is not interested in gaming. She made that pretty clear. She just went this first time for support, but you don't expect her to be at every gaming showdown, you know, because she's just not interested in that. So where Lene, she is. So,
and it seems like Kev has kind of put her in the category as like one of the boys, like the homie.
Well, she put herself in that category. I mean,
because he did want something with her.
Yeah,
exactly.
But I bet you if she would have known, she would have been there to support him. She would have been right beside him.
She would have.
And the fact that he lost to that boy,
I know.
Was really killing him in that fighting game. He got his little feelings and his ego crushed.
He's coming back. He gonna get that money.
He may, but you know, you don't just watch somebody, you know, and you think that you're just so good that nobody can whip you. You know, you gotta have a little sense of humility. I mean, you know, it would have been better you sat down and proved your point than to run your mouth and get beat like that.
But I think he got big-headed because the last time he went to one of those events, he crushed those little white
boys. Yeah, exactly.
Wait a minute. Hence, little white boys. It's an older grown man, or at least an older, I don't know if he, well, he seemed to be more like in his early 20s, maybe.
Yeah, more mature. He's mature than everybody. Yeah.
And he's played probably that game 1,000,000,000 times, so. Right. You just a little young boy now. Have a little humility, you know. Respect your elders. You should have sat down and you know, filled him out a little bit, or maybe see him play one more hand, one more game. But you just gonna sit down and think that you can beat him because of what?
Well, he did ask him. He said, "Oh my God, how did you do that?" Yeah. Like that move when he killed him. Like he was like, "How did you do that?" That's something he didn't know, you know. So
like I said,
it does seem like there's a little while there's competition there. It seems like the dude is extending him some camaraderie too, and kind of like.
Yeah, he told him to come back. Yeah. So,
well, yes, so I can beat you again. Come on back so I can whip your butt again. That's what he's saying. I think he respected the fact that he challenged him in the first place. And that does show respect. And, you know, but I think he's probably saying, well, next time you come back, we'll get your butt beat again.
Well, we'll see. Overall, I think this was a really good episode. A lot going on that we could look forward to, especially for next week, because it looked like it's a lot.
Right.
And I really do want to see where all of this is going. Of course, we have this big Tiff, Emmett, Keisha situation with Rod, and it's like, that's going to be probably a big thing going forward. Because I don't see how that storyline just falls off a cliff. That's going to be a long storyline going forward.
Right.
A lot of these relationships are on the rocks. Like I said, I hope Jada and Darnell can get it together. And I hope that Jemma and Jake get it together, as well as Trig. I hope he really becomes decisive in what he's going to do professionally and his relationships. And then, of course, the shadiness. I don't know. I still think that Quentin is going to be getting up out of here.
Yeah, I do too.
And we'll see how that fares for Tiff, since she is stepping foot in that world too. So I don't know. It's a lot. But I enjoyed our conversation, though.
I did too. And I want to say that there's one thing about Kevin. You know, Kevin has been through a lot, you know, with the Ronnie thing, Cougie, all of that, losing Brandon and everything like that, and even indulging in substances and all that. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to see him in the gaming world and channeling that energy into something like that.
Yes, I agree.
Because he could be out here getting in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that he's in the gaming world, that's cool, and it's positive, because there's some gamers out here making millions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Literally.
Yeah. I'm like, you know, kudos to Kevin.
Yeah, I'm happy to see that too.
And he said that because she asked him, was there any money in it? He was like, yeah, it's possible money in it.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of money. That, like, some people drop out of school, meaning like drop out of college, to play games and become millionaires.
But where, that game of Pootie Pie, his net worth was $54 million.
But now some colleges have adopted
EA Sports.
Gaming as a sport. So that just goes to show you that the money
is serious.
Yeah, because the colleges are now wanting a piece of that pie.
Well, here in Philadelphia, they just built a new facility specifically for gaming. Mm-hmm. Right next to the casino. And it's dope, right? So it's real.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'd rather see him doing that than being on the block.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Or in a game, because you know Chicago.
That's exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Kudos to the showrunner, the writers, everybody for incorporating that, because I think and we've heard this echo from some people who are in Chicago saying, you know, I wish that it was really like we could see this type of stuff in our community. And I think in our interview with the cast from the show, they were saying, you know, it's not that it's not happening. It's more so it's not publicized. It's not always in the media. Right. Positive things that are going on in the community. So I'm glad that, you know, this show is highlighting not only the positive stuff that's going on, but also sparking ideas on how they can make changes. Because, you know, some people think the show is like too optimistic on how Chicago is, and it's really not realistic sometimes. And it's like, well, no, sometimes you have to put it in front of people and let them see what it could be.
Right.
It's balance.
Yeah. And so I think it is a balance, and it's showing some of the reality, but it's also giving you, you know, be the change you want to see. If you see this show and it sparks an idea and talking about community and talking about addressing issues and just how to be mature in a lot of these situations and not always go and seek revenge on, you know, somebody that did something to you. I think that it's a really kind of like a blueprint too for what things could be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So congratulations to all involved. Kudos to the writers for being very positive in how they portray these Black characters.
Mm-hmm.
And not just putting the same old, you know, narrative out there about the negativity.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I appreciate the cast, Genesis Hale, Judaea Brown, Jason Weaver for joining us. If you haven't checked out that interview, go and check it out. It's truly an amazing interview. It's so much fun. And I think you would truly enjoy it. So go look at that. Also, make sure you subscribe to our channel. Click that subscribe button and the like button and the notification bell, because we got a lot more good content coming your way. And we appreciate the support. And I would love if our numbers reflect that. So, mm-hmm. You know, that's the bottom line.
Bottom line.
Yeah. Make sure you guys drop down in the comment section too and let us know your thoughts about this episode and your predictions for the future.
And there's another bottom line too. The subscription button is in the lower right hand corner.
That bottom line. Yes.
Yeah.
We are also on all major social media platforms at The Spot Real Talk, so you can follow us there as well. And again, Hassan, we thank you for joining us. It's always a pleasure to have you.
Absolutely.
Always. I'm happy to be here. You know, I'm here for you guys.
You're welcome anytime. So I think on that note, we are going to call it a night, and we will see you all next week for the next episode of The Shy. Have a good night, and go watch that interview.
Don't forget to subscribe.
Please. Bye-bye. Got a shameless necklace on me decorated. Artists got me feeling jaded. Hold up, I'll be waiting. Bad thing on my radar. Told me that I'm in a playlist. Flower bomb, she a lotus. I be thinking that I'm famous. I remember when I prayed for this. No sleep, cause I'm anxious. All this shit for entertainment. Crazy thinking that it's day one. All this business for the taking. Yeah. Hold it down for the nameless.